Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now, this is the third lecture regarding the understanding of pharmacology or developing the concepts of the subject of pharmacology. So, after completion of pharmacokinetic, in which we discussed salient or important feature of absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion, now we are going to start now pharmacodynamic. Pharmacodynamic means actually three aspects. First is where it acts. Obviously, that means site of action. So, this site of action may be the receptor. Remember, these are the normal physiological sites, physiological receptors involved in routine physiological cholinergic system, physiological adrenergic, and physiological dopaminergic. But when those physiological receptors are being occupied from outside by the drugs, they will be utilized by those drugs and will modify the effects of the system. So when we will give usually? Obviously, when normal physiological cholinergic activity is disturbed. So disturbed physiology means pathophysiology. And pathophysiology obviously means a disease. So we will modify the receptor by the drug to again rehabilitate or again to keep the cholinergic system at the normal physiological level. So basic purpose of the drug is to normalize the activity again, and that is the health then again. So remember, receptors or any other sites are actually present for the normal physiological and biochemical effects, and only those sites are being used by the drugs when given from outside. Similarly, there may be enzyme like cholinesterases. These enzymes are especially involved in ester type drugs, for example, acetylcholine and its other family members. Similarly, few of the local anesthetic agents you will study, ester nature, they are also metabolized by the enzyme cholinesterase. Xanthine oxidase, in biochemistry, you come across with this name of enzyme. This enzyme is involved in the synthesis of uric acid. Then cyclooxygenase enzyme. These enzymes are involved in the synthesis of the prostaglandin. So, like receptors, if occupied by the drug, this enzyme may be activated or may be blocked according to the requirement. If the activity is decreased, obviously we will try to activate it. If the activity is increased due to these, obviously we will try to block it. Similarly, the other site of action may be the ionic fluxes, like sodium influx, calcium influx, potassium influx, and so on. So, whatever the function these ionic fluxes are producing by activating or opening or blocking these ionic channels, the effects may be modified. So, these may be the site of action. How it acts? Mechanism of action, obviously. So, whatever we have studied, by modifying the receptor, our enzyme, our influxes, there may be some changes later on going on in the body. For example, there may be increase in cyclic AMP or cyclic GMP, or opposite, decrease in cyclic AMP or cyclic GMP, or inhibition of cyclooxygenase usually, and sodium potassium ATPase, and a few of the enzymes. So mechanism of action, by modifying all these, the drug may show their effects. What are the effects? What changes are produced by the drugs by acting on these receptor or enzyme or influxes? For example, because these are produced by the drugs, so those are the drug effects or pharmacological effects. For example, few effects may be very good, useful, so they are uses. They are usable. Few of the effects usually we don't want to see to be produced. But obviously, if the drug chemical structure is like that, it will produce. So those may become the adverse effects. Here's the example. Force of contraction may be increased of the heart. So obviously, in few of the cases like in cardiac failure, force of contraction is decreased. So in cardiac failure, our aim is to increase the force of contraction. So we can use such drug which can increase the force of contraction. And one of the drugs you have come across in physiology, like digoxin. Similarly, stimulation of vomiting center. So usually nobody wants to produce vomiting or to induce vomiting. But at time, for example, in few of the cases of this poisoning, if the poisonous material is still present in the stomach, we would like to induce vomiting. So that time it is the use. But usually it becomes the severe adverse effects. Similarly, bone marrow depression. Obviously, this is not any use, but obviously one of the adverse effects, because due to bone marrow depression, all three types of cells, RBC count, WBC count, or platelet counts, may be decreased. And accordingly, anemia or decreased immunity or bleeding tendency may occur as per effects of these cells. Now, these pharmacological effects, as we have discussed, may be desirable or undesirable. So obviously, desirable become the uses because they are usable, while the undesirable, not useful, not usable, so those may become the side effects or toxic effects. So undesirable effects, as I've told you, side effects, adverse, there is some slight difference, but we'll discuss later on, inshallah. But actually, side effects mean, in particular patient, unused pharmacological effects. I give here an example. One of the drugs, promethazine, commonly useful in as a household remedy under the name of Phenergon. Usually it has multiple effects it can produce. It can produce sedation, it can produce dryness of secretion, or it can decrease the itching, or it can stop the vomiting. So obviously these four effects, usually no patient is having all these symptoms at a time. Otherwise, only one drug will be sufficient. But if this drug is used only in any of these particular effect, for example, in vomiting. So as antiemetic means anti-vomiting. So obviously vomiting will be relieved, but sedation and dryness of mouth, etc., those will become the side effects in that particular patient. While it may be used in few of the children to induce sleep, so then this will become the use, and dryness of mouth, etc., will become the side effects in other that particular child or patient. Adverse effects, as we have told you, these are the severe types of effects, usually not required, as we have told you, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, bone marrow depression, or other similar effects. Toxic effects, remember, these are the effects produced by the normal therapeutic dose and normal therapeutic level. But if due to any reason, levels are increased of that drugs, toxic levels are achieved. So obviously those will become the toxic effect. For example, usually pharmacological toxic effects are the exaggeration of the therapeutic effects due to toxic level. For example, insulin decreases the blood glucose level and useful in diabetic patients. But if due to increased level of insulin, this decreased level or become in severity, it will be severe hypoglycemia and patient may go into shock, what we call as hypoglycemic shock. So this is the simple exaggeration of its routine pharmacological therapeutic effect. Similarly, warfarin or heparin, they are anticoagulant. useful in different types of thrombotic state. So therapeutic effect is anticoagulant, but due to increased level of heparin or warfarin, there may be bleeding in that particular patient. Pathological effects, usually these are the effects of those drugs on pathological changes, usually in the histological or other physiological effects. So again, due to toxic level, for example, ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, bone marrow depression, neurotoxicity, etc., etc. Genotoxic simply means toxic to the genetic level. Intolerance is actually a simple English word usually used as that particular patient, when given a drug, is not able to tolerate it because the patient may start having vomiting or headache or any other symptom which is not liked by the person. So we usually use the terminology intolerance. The person is not tolerating the drug. While actual tolerance means it is the decreased response of a drug, gradual decrease, aista, when given in this routine therapeutic schedule, once a day, twice a day, whatever the therapeutic schedule of a particular patient is, if it is producing gradual decrease, aista kam hota ja raha hai, we'll call it tolerance. But usually this tolerance is relieved if we give some increase in dosages or some interval in the dosage schedule. Tachyphylaxis is also the decrease, but it is rapid decrease in the response of a drug, tachyphylaxis. So difference between tolerance and tachyphylaxis is, in tolerance there is gradual decrease, in tachyphylaxis there is rapid decrease of when given repeatedly within short interval. Idiosyncrasy, idiom is abnormal. So it's an abnormal response, unwanted effect and unexpected. Other effects are expected, normal therapeutic effects, whatever the effects, those will be expected in all the patients taking that particular drug. But if abnormal response, which is appearing in any of few of the patient only, very, very rarely, not all the patient, and those effects are not a part of its pharmacological therapeutic effect, but abnormal response, then it is increasing. Hypersensitivity reaction simply means allergic reaction or immunological response. We know there are four types, type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. Hypersensitivity reaction we will study, inshallah, with the help of pathology also. First of all, tolerance. As I've told you, after attaining the full response with the therapeutic, it's a gradual decrease in the response of a drug when given its therapeutic schedule. As I told you, if the same pharmacological effects response is required, usually we increase the dose. Like in case of opioids, or barbiturate, or benzodiazepine, or even alcohol. But there are some conditions in which the increase in dosage is not solving the problem, but we have to give some proper dosage interval, like use of nitroglycerin. Opposite to tolerance, the another word is used, resistance. This is usually complete loss of response. And usually this results in with the therapeutic drug, chemotherapeutic agents, like used for in antimicrobial, anti-tubercular, antiviral, anti-cancer, etc. So if the decrease was not tachyphylaxis, on the other hand, it is the rapid decrease in the response of a drug when it is administered repeatedly over a short period of time. And a common example we will study later on, inshallah, indirectly acting sympathomimetic, a most important group is the amphetamines or ephedrine, etc. And then hydralazine, this is a vasodilator useful in hypertension. So if they are used repeatedly within a short interval, their response will be decreased rapidly. The common reason is usually rapid exposure of the drug to the tissue and it becomes desensitized or insensitive. So that is why increasing the dose of the drug will not solve the problem, as we have seen in the toddlers. Here we have to give some interval, proper interval and time to the tissue to regain its sensitivity, as I have told you in hydralazine, and even nitroglycerin, that also shows tachyphylaxis, or even tolerance also, this nitrate nitrous. But in here, in both the cases, we have to give interval. Iatrogenic effect. Now here, iatrogenic means produced by the physician, caused by the patient. So usually these are the harmful effects of a drug when it is used for some other problem. I will give the example and then you will understand. For example, adrenocortic steroids. So they are very useful as anti-inflammatory, rheumatoid arthritis or any other inflammatory condition for prolonged period. So one of the most important adverse effects of corticosteroid is Cushing syndrome. So this Cushing syndrome is the iatrogenic effect. So because it is produced by the drug which has been prescribed by the physician, so we call such effects as iatrogenic effect. Idiosyncrasy, as I've told you previously, idio means abnormal. So abnormal, unexpected response of a drug, usually due to some genetic differences in the metabolism or genetic difference in the responsiveness or hypersensitivity. For example, glucose-6-phosphate deiodine deficiency, it may produce hemolytic anemia with primaquine, one of the anti-malarial, or sulfonamides. Sulfonamides, you have come across this name in biochemistry. So such type effects are produced by these drugs are known as idiosyncrasies. Simply, aplastic anemia by bone marrow depression, especially one of the antibacterial drug chlorpheniramine. This is a very important example. You must remember this example because frequently asked in the Viva, MD, MCQ, etc. Aplastic anemia due to chlorpheniramine. Now here I will also explain you okay. Important one, aplastic anemia is due to idiosyncratic. Remember, these effects are irreversible. Once bone marrow depression has occurred, it is not reversible. But this chlorpheniramine can produce the same aplastic anemia, not due to idiosyncratic reaction, but due to toxic effects. Now, if this aplastic anemia will be produced by the toxic effects, that should be reversible. Okay, then if we will decrease the level or decrease the dose of the drug, toxic level decrease and aplastic anemia will be reversed. Supersensitivity. Obviously, this is the increased responsiveness of the tissue receptor. And it is happening with the usual therapeutic doses or even with the endogenous substance. This you have already studied in physiology, I will explain you. And this is usually due to upregulation of this. Upregulation means increased number of receptors. In physiology, you come across with the injury to nerve. And there you observe that when there is injury to nerve, usually there is increased response of the drugs, and that happens due to increased number of receptors to which there is nerve supplying. Apart from that example, other most important example is beta 1 receptor present in the heart. If they are blocked for longer period, their number is increased, upregulation occur. Similarly, cholinergic receptors blocked by the thiazanthine, one of the antipsychotics. We will explain these things when we will discuss in beta blocker or antipsychotic, okay, how they are increased, produce increased responsiveness or supersensitivity. Now, don't confuse with the supersensitivity. That was increased responsiveness. This is hypersensitivity. This is allergic reaction, immunological problem. As I told you previously, four types. Type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, which is ranging from simple skin rashes to severe acute anaphylaxis in which patient go into shock, what we call acute anaphylactic shock. As I told you, the drug is not used alone. They may be given more than one drug at a time, two, three, four, like that. So at times when they are given in combination, they interact with each other. So I told you drug interaction means when the drug affect the effects of each other. So they may be additive. Additive simply means addition. More sedation with the addition of same depressants. There may be variety of drug depressant scenes. When they are combined, usually the level of sedation will be the sum of either drugs. Synergistic, here I should also example give the additive. Additive means 1 plus 1 makes 2. So one level of sedation by one drug, other one level of sedation by the other drug, and when they are given combined together, result will be 2. So double will be the sedation. So additive. Now again synergistic. It simply means when the drugs are given together, they can increase the effects in combination. That means 1 plus 1 is more than 2. Example is, if we combine with penicillin, it is one of the antibacterial agent, and aminoglycoside, this is also another group used as antibacterial. When they are combined together, they increase the antibacterial microbial activity and spectra. Spectra means the types of microorganisms which are being destroyed or being killed by the drugs. So they increase the antimicrobial spectrum. So when they were used alone, penicillin has limited microorganisms against which penicillin are useful. Similarly, aminoglycosides are also useful against similar number or different types of microorganisms. But when they are given combination, the types of these antimicrobial agents will be much increased. Potentiation is a simple pharmacologic response of a combination of drug which is greater than the sum of the individual response, some sort of difference between synergism. In synergism, both the or every drug is having its own effects also, but in potentiation, one of the drug may be having absolutely negligible effect. So to explain it, usually mathematically people say 0 plus 1 is more than 1. Just to explain you. So in potentiation, the pharmacological response of combination greater than the sum of the individual response. Antagonistic effect by combination, simply when the drugs are opposing or blocking the effects of each other. We will come across later on, inshallah, various types of antagonism. Now, some explanation of potentiation. These are the examples. Levodopa and carbidopa. Levodopa, we know, is useful in Parkinsonism, while carbidopa is not having any anti-Parkinsonian effects, but it is inhibiting the peripheral metabolism of levodopa. So, obviously, less and less levodopa will be metabolized dopamine in peripheral, and more will be available at the level of blood membrane, and that will cross and will enter to brain and will be available to produce its anti-Parkinsonian effects. Noradrenaline and cocaine. Now, there are few conditions in which deficiency of noradrenaline is producing problem. For example, depression. This is one of the mental condition. So we want to increase the level of noradrenaline in such patient. So whatever the noradrenaline is released at the nerve ending in the brain will be useful to treat the to relieve the depressive symptom. But if the deficiencies occurred, we can use cocaine also, because whatever noradrenaline is released, major part of noradrenaline is reuptake. But some level of noradrenaline remains there to show its effect to bind with the receptor and to relieve the symptom of depression. Cocaine, by inhibiting the uptake of norepinephrine, will lead to more and more noradrenaline available for the receptor and to show its more and more antidepressant effect. Similarly, sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim, one of the very old useful combination of sulfonamides, ceftriaxone, bactroprime, etc. But collectively, this is known as cotrimoxazole. Now, this combination is blocking the synthesis of folic acid in a sequential way. So these are the few examples of potentiation. Antagonistic combination, chemical at molecular level, for example, neutralizing chemically. We are using antacid to relieve the burning sensation of the stomach due to acid activity, which is increased in some sort of gastritis. Or protamine is useful to chemically neutralize the effects of heparin in case of toxic effects of heparin bleeding tendency. Physiological or functional antagonism simply mean producing the opposite physiological effects to each other. For example, insulin is producing hypoglycemia, glucagon is increasing level of glucose level. So they are opposing each other, but by acting at their own site, own receptors, and producing opposite effect to each other. Similarly, histamine is producing vasodilation and bronchospasm, while adrenaline is producing that peripheral vasoconstriction but bronchodilation. So in severe allergic reaction, that is why we use adrenaline to nullify the effects of histamine. Pharmacological, that means at the receptor level, by producing competition at the site of receptor, pharmacological effects. So, or there may be non-competitive also, we will study later on, inshallah, in detail. Dispositional means at the plasma protein binding site. As I told you, the plasma protein are the site where usually all the drugs they bind. But if given two or more than two drugs together, obviously for binding with the plasma protein, competition will start. And which has more attraction, more affinity to bind with the plasma protein, that will occupy more number of plasma protein. And the other drugs, due to the presence of that particular drug, will not be able to bind with the plasma protein. So obviously, more and more amounts of those drugs will be in free form. And free form can be distributed to the various sites of body and can show the effects. So toxic effects usually seen with such types of drug interaction. Now there may be some severe, as I told you, genetic level damage to the fetus during pregnancy, simple from developmental stage to other sites, right from this at the level of nidation, even fetal death can occur. When the organ development starts, usually malformation of the organs happen. Ek baazu nahi hai, ek taang nahi hai, hont kate hue, vagera vagera. Or fetus growth and maturation has started after some time, then functional disturbance starts happening. Or even it can be at the very first level, developmental stage, age of the fetus in weeks, okay, at any level. Or damage due to fetus during lactation. Obviously, drugs may be secreted into milk. So depending upon the quantity the baby is taking along the milk can produce or can show the effects of that particular drug. That will become the unwanted effects in the child. Here, like that also. The sensitivity site of action may be increased and there will be increased effect. Now, few of the terminologies we want to explain them. That is therapeutic range. So, actually, it is the range between the minimum therapeutic concentration and minimum maximum therapeutic concentration. This is the minimum below which there will be no therapeutic effect. Maximum therapeutic means above which toxic effect will start. So, range between minimum therapeutic and maximum therapeutic is the therapeutic range. Another terminology we will use and we will explain it later on, that will be therapeutic window. That will be range between minimum therapeutic and the minimum toxic, because maximum therapeutic and minimum toxic are usually just adjacent to each other. One step low is the maximum therapeutic, one step above is the minimum toxic. So accordingly terminology is used. So therapeutic range is the range between minimum and maximum therapeutic concentration. Therapeutic window is the range between minimum therapeutic concentration and minimum toxic concentration. So these are the three types of dosages of the same drug. With the first dose that was so small dose, even minimum therapeutic concentration cannot be achieved. Then with slight increase, so now we can get, but that lived only for a short period. And then we further increase, which obviously remain for a longer period. Accordingly, we calculate the dosage of particular drugs also. Now, few more definition. Posology means branch of pharmacology which deals with the dosage of the drugs. Chemotherapy means drugs useful in different types of bacterial infection or viral or fungal or against cancer, etc. And toxicology, as the name is showing it, simply means to observe the severe adverse or toxic effect due to toxic amounts or poisoning of the drug. Similarly, pharmacogenetic means dealing with the genetic aspects of the drugs. Pharmacy means that branch of pharmacology in which we observe the preparation, compounding and dispensing of a medicinal substance so that the patient may be given safe, effective and affordable drugs. Pharmacognosis simply means the recognition of the drug. Okay, what is the source? How we can identify them? What are their physical and chemical properties and characteristics of drugs which are usually obtained from the plants? Thank you very much. This was the first part of pharmacodynamic, and then inshallah tomorrow we will see the second part of the pharmacodynamic. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.